question, so I just want you guys to kind of think about all of your school memories from where you started to where you are now.
On behalf of the faculty of Geneva Academy, I would like to welcome you to join with us as we celebrate the academic achievement of these two young women, Caitlin and Heidi. An ancient philosopher once said, "The root of education is bitter, but its fruit is sweet." This is clearly seen in the lives of Heidi and Caitlin, in the countless grueling hours spent on math drills and sentence diagrams, violin lessons, Latin conjugations and physics labs, page-long calculus solutions and economics lessons that make you want to cry. Don't forget the last-minute cramming for the speech meet. We know you do that. Or the 50-page nightly omnibus readings of books that are older than dirt, also known as classic literature. Or the 30-plus page capstone thesis paper. Did I mention last-minute cramming? Yes, the roots of education can be bitter. The education that Heidi and Caitlin received was not a walk in the park. It was more like one of Mr. Ritchie's Midnight Hikes of Mount Thielson, where students slash victims are marched up a mountain trail in the dark for hours and hours in the middle of the night before mustering just enough strength to scramble up the rocky precipice to the literally freezing cold summit. Fun? Maybe. Worth it? I think Heidi and Caitlin wouldn't hesitate to agree that the grueling ascent, though bitter at times, had an oh-so-sweet end. Yes, it was hard, but yes, it was worth it. And isn't that exactly what we must remind ourselves, parents, that it's worth it? If we desire children who mature into virtuous and God-fearing adults, the easy way is never the best way. I've seen for myself how Heidi and Caitlin's parents, the Duclos and the Rileys and the Parks, have steadily poured themselves into their daughters throughout the years, nurturing, admonishing, loving, challenging, guiding, and teaching, all because they knew it was worth it. If the fruit of education is sweet, it is only because the prayers of the parents have tilled the ground in their daughters' hearts, and their tears have nourished the soil. Heidi and Caitlin, your education was truly a labor of love. A labor not just for you, but for your parents, your teachers, and countless others who have poured their hearts into your lives. Let that thought humble you. You are so dearly loved. And today, we do acknowledge your achievement, and we celebrate the fruit of your education, you. You have made it to a summit, but yet, there's still more to climb. And no, I'm not gonna start singing Miley Cyrus's The Climb, but I did think about it. But I will quote another famous philosopher. In the words of C.S. Lewis, this school community invites you, challenges you. Don't stop. Come further up. Come further in. We love you. Congratulations.
It's my privilege and honor to get to introduce the valedictorian. This is Heidi Duclo, but before I do, I'd also like to say a word or two. I spent quite a bit of time with Heidi through the years and watched her literally bounce up mountains that others are trudging up to see the sunrise with me at Mount Thielson. But, you know, the world's in such disarray around us. Everybody's running, to coin the phrase or use the phrase, running helter-skelter. They don't know where they're going. They don't know why. They don't know where they've come from. They have no sense of direction, no sense of purpose. They just run, run, run. They know not where to or for what purposes. And it's so neat to come together and be celebrating a building up of accomplishment. That's community coming together in a way that we're seeing the antithesis of that in our culture and around the world. And so here we get to celebrate. I often pray that God would make me and those around me fine, precise, strong instruments. carry out his kingdom building. I'm really confident when you see young ladies that he's done that, he's answered that prayer. Without further ado, I'll have Heidi come up. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I wish I could say that at my time at Geneva, I learned how not to procrastinate. However, I'd be lying if I told you I did not write the speech at 1 a.m. So what did I learn at Geneva? Well, my education here encapsulated somewhere around 60 books, all written by great authors such as Plato, Thucydides, and George Orwell, and brought in a classical approach to writing, geometry, and the study of literature and art history. We learned how to mathematically deduce pi, the way that Archimedes did, or how to logically defend our faith, the history of our culture, and the philosophy of mankind, and so much more. Looking back at the 4 years I have attended high school here, I can truly say that I have learned more about myself, those around me, and my creator. I have learned that the good things in life rarely come easy, but that with diligence, patience, and love, you can pull through any challenge. Geneva taught me how to academically study and perform well, but more importantly, it gave me strong connections with peers and teachers that will last a lifetime. I didn't just make friends here, I became part of it. Mr. Turner, from showing us Looney Tunes during class, to playing Mafia with us in a haunted tavern in Boston, or dancing in the car to Indian music all the way to our aesthetics trip, you gave Caitlin and I some of the best high school memories and taught us not only to look for the true, good, and beautiful, but to emulate and become. Mr. Hallgrimson, you taught us many things, how to read well, how to write well, but most importantly, how to play basketball well. You were there for us when we needed a wise counselor, friend, or a great quality. You made high school not only a place of education, but somewhere we could laugh and go cry. Mr. Ritchie, your economics classes and random speeches about technology and the modern world showed us just how much we need to answer your questions. But on a serious note, thank you so much for showing us the reality of the world we are about to face and helping us to prepare for the future. Mrs. Warren, Mrs. Kirkman, Mr. Figueroa, Pastor Seeker, Mr. Sir, Mrs. Shalard, and all of the other teachers and staff of Geneva, thank you for your time, your patience, and care in raising up the youth to be outstanding citizens. Last, but definitely not least, I would like to thank you, the parents, friends, and family, for being incredible support to us throughout our high school journey. We would not be here before you today if it wasn't for your love and encouragement. Well, by now, you may be expecting me to give some life advice about success and hope for the future. However, I am 17 and I don't know what I'm going to college for yet or what I will even do once this graduation weekend is over. But if there's one thing I learned at Geneva, it is to look to history for the elders. As Ralph Waldo Emerson said concerning success and how to attain it, quote, to laugh often and much, to win the respect of intelligent people and the affection of children, to earn the appreciation of honest critics and endure the betrayal of false friends, to appreciate beauty, to find the best in others, to leave the world a bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden patch, or a redeemed social condition, to know even one life has breathed easier than the other. This is to have succeeded. For the upcoming classes, success is not about how much you will be paid in your future job or how many people will like you. Success happens when you learn to love others before yourself and to put God above all else. Success does not just come with age, either. I distinctly remember watching the class of 2016 graduate and thinking that they had it all together. Well, I will tell you as a graduating senior that at this age, we do not. I don't have to tell you that life is crazy and goes by way too fast, but my challenge to you is to live every day as if it were the last. Spend that extra moment to hug your mom on the way to school. Be patient with a sibling. Be kind and respectful to your teachers. Learn from the mistakes of others, and in all you do, do it with love. look back and say, wow, I left the world a better place, you will have succeeded. Kate, over the last 4 years, you have become one of my closest friends, and I will cherish the memories that we have made here for the rest of my life. By now in the speech, I'm supposed to tell you, my class, to go conquer the world. But instead, I challenge you not to go conquer the world, but to make it a better place. Not in some drastic way, but little by little, in everything that you do, show the world Jesus through you. Caitlin, you have been given the greatest gift from the Creator, the ability to create. So as you go on from here, create. Create art, make music, and form in the hearts of others the love that your Creator has for you. We don't know what the future holds. No one could have predicted that any of the stuff in the past few months would happen. And it is impossible to know what will happen even in the next few hours or days. But as 1 Corinthians 15:58 says, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Thank you, and have a blessed day.
So as I looked at these, I thought I couldn't help it. And, you know, the root scripture definitely is a serious thing. And yet, before I get to that, I have to say I could not help but think of the parallel here in Deuteronomy 6. These are the words of Moses speaking to the Israelites after about 38 years in the wilderness. And they're getting ready to go into the promised land. And the comical parallel is just too much for me, that, you know, 4 years in high school is a lot like 4 years in the wilderness. And the promised land of adulthood, I mean, talk about a serious thing. You know, you are not a kid anymore. So, you know, I'll read directly here, except in toward the end, you know, this version, there are a few places where I add my own. So Moses spoke to the Israelites to remind them that as they made this transition from, you know, this wilderness experience to an experience of being in the promised land, that their minds were going to be almost anywhere else but on God. And God spoke, speaking to Moses, wanted them to remember him and for good reason. So he said to Moses, and had Moses say the following: these are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live, by keeping all these decrees and commandments that I give you, so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in the land flowing with your companion, just as the Lord your God, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up, as they remain in your hands. Tie them as symbols on your hands. That's symbolic of your work, of all the things you do, symbols of God's commands are to be part of everything you do. I live symbols on your hands and bind them on your forehead, meaning all you think, eternal loads, the thoughts that could be interwoven with thoughts about God. I live symbols on your hands and bind them on your forehead. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. This means really, as Jesus said later, of him who is ashamed of me, I will be ashamed of him before the Father. When you put it out there, you don't put it under a bushel. You know, you're letting people know that you're a Christian and that they're going to put it in God's pleasure.
Father Eric Riley has given a father's charge both for Cole's graduation and Logan's graduation. And when he was deployed to Kosovo, we knew we had a little bit of a challenge. And so he recorded this, this charge that we're about to see.
Good morning from Camp Wattsteel. And maybe I should say good evening. Depends on what time zone your perspective is right now. But regardless, I'm honored to be able to have an opportunity to say a few words to Geneva Academy's 2020 graduating class. Girls, obviously, I would prefer to be there, but just know that I am there with you in my heart as we go through this work. As I begin to prepare for this father's charge, I could not help but reflect on the unprecedented and extraordinary times that we are living in. And it's not lost on me that this year, your senior year is probably not the year that you had expected. And I can speak from a parent's point of view, and I'm sure the teachers would agree with me as well. In fact, girls, you might even be a little frustrated or disappointed on how things have turned out, because it's been anything but normal. But I can assure you, this year will be a year that you will never forget. As I thought about the year I graduated from high school, I tried to remember anything of significance that occurred that year, and I couldn't remember a single thing. However, a quick search on Google helped me remember that Walk Like an Egyptian by the Bengals was number one on the pop charts, that President Ronald Reagan and Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev signed a weapons treaty, that Microsoft launched Windows 2.0, and then a squirrel shut down the NASDAQ stock exchange by blowing it through a phone line. While these facts may have seemed important at the time, they weren't important enough to be etched in my memory for immediate recall today. Caitlin and Heidi, this year, this time, on the other hand, your graduation will be a year you'll never forget. As if the senior year in high school isn't challenging enough with the uncertainties of what lie ahead, the prospects of a bright future, it's the end to an era of a very important time in your life. And of course, there's a capstone project that Mr. Halverson pushed you on incessantly throughout the year. I would further characterize this year as a VUCA environment. When I was in the United States Army War College, we learned to describe strategic military political situations based on its volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous nature. Well, from what I've observed here in Kosovo, 2020 has been anything but normal, and could probably best be described as volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. I need not go into detail about what's going on around the world, what's happening in our nation, and what's happening even in the state of Oregon for you to probably agree with me that we are living in some interesting times. And thinking about what I wanted to share with Caitlin and Heidi today, the word resilience or resiliency came to mind. While in many instances this word is used casually or flippantly, but it is a char- characteristic that we all have in us. Researchers will debate whether or not you were born a resilient individual or if it's a trait or characteristic that you learn. It has also become very popular in corporate America to have resiliency training. And I can tell you that the United States Army has incorporated resiliency training into annual requirements for every single soldier. I would argue that resiliency is both an innate and a learned character, but it is a lifelong undertaking. The dictionary defines resilience as the ability to recover from or adjust easily to adversity or change. The U.S. Army further goes on to define resiliency as the mental, physical, emotional, and behavioral ability to face and cope with adversity, adapt to change, recover, learn, and grow from setbacks. While I am certainly no professional resiliency trainer or a research scientist looking at the different aspects of how one can be or become more resilient, I can say that the graduating class of 2020 has had a crash course in resiliency. I would like to share a few thoughts with you on your faith, on how your faith and your ever-loving God provides you with resiliency in challenging times. Philippians 4:13 says, "I can do all things through him who strengthens me." Now, when Paul penned this message to the Philippians, it was intended to be a message of encouragement. At the time, Paul was imprisoned, and there would be no question that it would be a period in his life where depression and anguish could set in and rule his thoughts and actions. Girls, over the years, I've watched both of you learn to love your God, our God, and depend on him in challenging times. Your actions and your words have shown your love for him, and I encourage to find that you both find your strength in him. Caitlin and Heidi, always remember that in him you can find strength to do things that are unimaginable. Aim high in your life goals and find great comfort in knowing that he is always there with you. Paul's instructions in Ephesians chapter 6 resonates well with me as a soldier. It provides a great portrayal of how we can find strength and courage in God to be resilient under any circumstance. Paul urges the Ephesians to be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might, to put the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Our loving God provides us with resiliency that not only he can provide, the strength that we are given through him and our faith in him will help us through any challenge. Paul goes on in Ephesians to describe the details of the kit or the equipment of a fully armed soldier, that which God provides when we put our faith in him. He says, "Stand therefore, having fastened on your belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, which with you can extinguish all flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with prayer and supplication." Obviously, this passage resonates well with me as a soldier. And as I sit here sharing these thoughts from over 6,000 miles away from home while deployed overseas, Caitlin, Heidi, I'd like to share a couple more simple thoughts on why God has equipped you so well in your faith. I'm saying this as from a father's perspective, and a little bit of advice going forward. Stand firm in the Lord and his love for you, and rely on his strength to guide you in life. Find confidence in the truth and the righteousness that he provides. Your faith in him will equip you to handle any situation. Be comforted in knowing that he is always with you. He is in control, he is good, and he is always victorious. in life, it is more important to be pleasing to God than to worry about what others think or say about how you should act or be. Share God with others, not only in words, but in your actions. Let your bright spirits be an example for others to follow. Be good listeners and strive to understand others by engaging in godly and productive discourse. And lastly, but certainly not least, love God. Isaiah 41:10 says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Girls, know that as parents, as teachers, and as a community, we are extremely proud of you and all that you have accomplished throughout your high school years. It's been an honor and a joy to watch both of you become beautiful and intelligent young women. And we all are all excited to see what God has in store for the next chapter of your life. Thank you, and God bless.
Tell you about everything this school has given to Heidi and I. All of the moments on the aesthetics trip to California and the late nights in Boston. All the times we ended up crying from laughing so hard. Whenever I think about the memories I've made here, a smile always comes to my face. This school is a place where you are not only a part of the classroom, but a part of the community. I want to start by thanking all of our teachers. Without you all, we would not have become the people we have grown to be. Mr. Turner and Mr. Hoggenson, thank you for caving in and joining Snapchat so we can all talk together in the group chat. Thank you, Mr. Ritchie, for showing us how much we really don't know about the world we live in. But on a more serious note, I am truly grateful for each one of you, and I'm so highly grateful. You all showed us what it means to be good Christians in the school. You have given us a great example that we can apply and live up to. We have learned the truth from our science and math classes. We have seen the beauty from our aesthetics and art classes, and we have strived for goodness through rhetoric and confidence. You all have truly made us into knowledgeable Christians, so we thank you for that. I also want to thank our parents. You have stood by our side through everything. You helped us to stay motivated, even when we had extremes in your eyes. You guys have always supported us through life, and we can't thank you enough for all that you do. And lastly, I would like to give a quick thanks to the rest of the class of 2020 of Geneva Academy. I would mention them all, but it might take too long. Except it's just Heidi. So, Heidi, thank you for always laughing with me and being insanely weird during our study halls. This year was definitely one of the best. Geneva Academy is a place where we have grown in knowledge of the Creator. With the knowledge we gained from the school, we are ready to go into this world to show the light of Christ. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "You must remember that intelligence is not enough. Intelligence plus character. That is the goal of true education." That is exactly what Geneva is doing for our students. Rather than just gaining knowledge and facts, we We are learning how to become ambassadors for Christ. We are learning to become tomorrow's leaders. For any younger students listening to this, I want to tell you all one thing that you need to remember. Enjoy where you are in life. Sometimes it's hard to be thankful for where you are, but before you know it, you will be all grown up and have to do some cool things. So enjoy going to the school, because pretty soon you'll be graduating too. I hope you can see how amazing the school is and how it will change you for the better. Being a student at Geneva Academy is a gift, so please treasure it. Some days it might seem impossible to keep going, but know that God will always get you through it. Remember to pray for those around you as well as your own heart. He will guide you in this life. I would now like to welcome Pastor Seeker to the stage. Pastor Seeker is the Latin teacher here at Geneva and has been a part of the board for over 10 years. He was also my Latin teacher when I first joined the school way back in 2010. With all of that being said, I will now have Pastor Seeker come to the stage. Thank you.
Joy to be here and to see these two. Congratulations. This is great. And it's amazing what happens as students develop and as they grow, they become different. It's good to watch that growth, that difference, to see them develop and see them become godly people. I'm excited about it. We're here to celebrate. In a way, the tremendous step that has been taken. And what I think we want to keep in mind tonight is graduation is something that makes the room get bigger, not smaller. And we need to focus on that, because I think it's very easy for us to fall into the trap of having the culture define this wonderful moment. And if the culture does, in any way at all, it takes away some of the joy of it. And so tonight, as Caitlin and Heidi are entering into a new phase of their life. It's a new phase, as has already been said. And they are what we call graduating. Now, this graduation ceremony, where did that all start? Where did that come from? The first one in history was in the late 1100s, early 1200s, with the first graduating classes of Oxford, Cambridge, and the School of France, the Sorbonne, as they put out new teachers. That's all they were teaching, were people to be teachers. And the word graduation comes from the Latin, which all good things do, the idea of gradus, which means a step. And it also, the word degree comes from the word gradus. So what we have these people taking a step in life, but they're also getting a degree. And that's all part of what graduation is. But in those days, there was no celebration in terms of the I-ness of this ceremony. And not that celebrating for the people and the graduates is wrong. I'm just talking about history. There was no celebration of the I-ness. And it was a focus on becoming another degree of teacher. So they started with the bachelor's, they went to the master's degree. There was no doctorate degree to begin with, and that developed later in the history of education. So it's easy for us to let the culture then take some of that away from us by putting in the romanticization that our culture is so good at. Everything has to be romanticized, so it gives people an impetus to go get it, rather than all that's been said here, to be people who are people of character. And so the culture has a three-tiered understanding of what it means to graduate. First tier of that is that it's time for me as a graduate to go out and to show the world what I know. You'll hear that in 90% of the commencement services. Go out, show the world what you know. And the focus there is on that student showing everybody what they know. Immediately the pressure comes on to that student. The second phase of this, or the second tier of this, is that with what I know, I'm going to go out and, as Heidi alluded to, change the world. And they're told that in every ceremony. You hear it all the time.
go out and take what you know and change the world as though we have the power to change the world. Now hang on, don't walk out yet. We'll see what's coming here. And thirdly, I have learned how to speak well. I can do the rhetoric thing. I know my audience. I understand these things. I've become a man or a woman speaking well and doing the work of speaking. I've learned how to write a complete sentence. That's amazing. And how to write a complete paragraph. And I've even learned how to point my finger at the direct object in the sentence, which is pretty amazing. After all, who can do that? Except graduates here, right? And so we are excited about the fact that that can happen. But what happens is we begin to think, I have gotten something that I can take out now, and I can convince people that they need to change or that they need Christ or whatever, because I can argue, I can put an argument together and make it last and make it stick, I can make it logic, I can do all these things that need to be done, I can write and talk and argue, and so therefore, I'm in good shape. So graduation in the West, in our culture, has focused on the graduate, taking what he learns or what she learns out into the world and making a difference and changing. The pressure is on the person to do this. And so, as I have spent my time in my life since the calling of God on my life some decades ago to go into the ministry, I have come to the idea to understand that these concepts, this three-tiered development, has come into the seminaries in a very real way in America. And so what we wind up with is they've come in, and when these ideas have come into the seminaries and the graduating classes, something has happened over the course of my lifetime, is that the people in ministry, and this is straightforward and not a fun thing to hear, people in ministry, the suicide rate in the ministry has raised to a level that is as high as any particular areas of profession. And you might say, well, why would that happen? I mean, that's not supposed to happen. After all, these are God's people, Christians. It's because in many seminaries, that work is so taxing, and there's so much academic pressure in a seminary, wheelbarrows full of papers and stuff to bring in and stuff to turn in and speaking all the time and all the pressure that's there. And people are taught all the skills that they need to change the world. They're taught how to speak well, they're taught how to write, they're taught how to put a message together, how to do hermeneutics, how to study, how to put all this together and interpret. And the pressure is great. You're in the graduate reading room from early morning till late night to get these things done. And so, they're ready to go. But when they get out into the church, the first church that they get, something happens to them. Their world gets among them. It's huge. And it's a powerful pressure. So what they find out is they graduated with all this information, and they come up and they can't answer the first question that comes across their life as they cross the door into this big room. It's called my first job, my first calling, or for you, whatever job you have. There's more questions that you didn't even know existed. There's more pain, seeing the kind of pain in people, feeling the pain yourself, maybe it's a rejection or whatever it may be, because you've never experienced it like that before, because somebody doesn't like what you're doing. And there's more pressure, much more. Pressure that you've never had before, because all of a sudden it's all up to me to change the world. And that pressure doesn't come from the world out there, it comes from Christianity. And during my generation, this may not be true now so much, but during my generation, the two things that were destructive to me, pastors, was the church growth movement, which finally came to the place where it could say, if your church isn't growing well, growing constantly all the time, then therefore the pastor isn't doing his job. Well, you can imagine how that makes the guy feel who is
takes his first church, it's a small church, the church down the street, his choir is bigger than his church. Makes him feel a little frustrated. It's painful, it hurts. And so he doesn't know what to do. And so as he wrestles with that, he goes to the bookstore, Christian bookstore, and he sees a book he's never seen before. He picks it up, turns it over the back for the bio, which was a mistake. And on the back it says, this book was written by so-and-so, who's pastoring a church of 15,000. He's 40 years old, he's written 38 books. You look at that and you begin to wonder, what am I doing? Am I really being used of God? Do I count? And that pressure comes on, and we all understand what pressure is to measure up. If you had it at home, you had it at school, you have it in all different phases of life. And many people can't handle it. It's a powerful pressure. And I had to deal with it. I had to work it through in my own heart, my own life. Because the character of many seminary graduates has not been addressed this way. Not that they've been bad seminaries. It's just that they haven't taken the guys aside and said, look, here, we need a class figuring out how to handle ourselves in these situations. And so graduates are trained, here's the problem, to do something rather than to be something. That is not true of the school. And that's why I'm committed to it. And that's why I'm so thankful. Because God has put together a bunch of people who want people to become rather than just be doers. So that what happens is people are trained to be successful rather than faithful in many places. And when the pressure is put on you to be successful rather than faithful, you're under pressure. 1 Corinthians 4:3, Paul says, he and all the people who carry the gospel are stewards of the mystery of Christ. And it's required of a steward that one be found what? Successful? That's not what it says. It says faithful. We're required to be faithful as stewards of the ministry. And the best example of this that has really helped me and really encouraged me is the life of John MacArthur. And the story was relayed to me, he was becoming very well known in the mid-1970s, just a few years after he graduated from seminary. And he was up there in that church, the Grace Community Church. And I think he took it in 69. And about 75, all of a sudden, people were just flocking to get into his church. And buildings started to appear on the property. It cost millions of dollars to build. And people were sending letters to him and calling him and asking him to send copies of his messages so they could play them on the Christian radios all over the United States. And one of his friends noticed that, and he said, man, John, he said, isn't this fantastic? I bet you're just having a blast. I bet this is so much fun. You're just having a great time. And John MacArthur, in his typical, you know, lighthearted way, you know how he is, very lighthearted, he's not. And he wasn't in this case. He said this. He said, look around you. Do you think what you see is easy and fun? He says, I want you to understand, I don't think it's fun. Because every single minute of my life, I have to deal with the battle of pride. And he says, I don't like. See, what he's talking about is my character has been exposed by this success. And I'm embarrassed. And he was honest about that. And I appreciated so much him saying that. Instead of saying, yeah, look at this, look what we did. He looked at it a different way. But you can see, he must have handled it pretty well. He was pretty successful today by cultural standards. But that's the issue. Are we going to look for a cultural definition of our success? Are we going to look for a biblical definition of our success? 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 4 through 6. Listen to this. Paul says, for when one says, I am of Apollo, or I am of Paul, and I am of Apollo, I am I'm of Apollos, then are you not mere men? What then is Apollos? And what is Paul? Their servant through whom you believe, even as the Lord gave opportunity to each one. The Lord gave the opportunity. The Lord made the changes in the life. And so it wasn't the people at all. And he says, you know this verse. I planted, Apollos watered. Who gave the increase? That has got to stick in our minds. We have got to hold that very close to us. This is not to say that what we learn in rhetoric or logic or history or anything else here, that it's worthless and it's not necessary. That's not the point. The point is, that is not so that you become the focus of everything and that all the weight and pressure on you is to produce success. That is not what your life is to be about. You may have success. There are people in our lives who are known worldwide for what they do. God gave that to them. But most of us don't have that. And so he would not give credit to his education and to who he was, Paul, to the success of his preaching. What Paul did was to be faithful every single day. He says his success was based on the power of the gospel. And you read in the book of Acts, Paul's life. One day he preached the gospel message. He was stoned. His body was dragged out of the city. He was left in the gutter for dead. Very unsuccessful day, right? No. So then his friends came around him since he got up. The next day, he preached in another city, the same message that got him stoned the day before, and there was this huge response. So it said he did that. God touched. And so what we should say, if we're going to be real accurate, is that Paul failed one day, and Paul was successful the next day. But you see, that's what we have to avoid. Because God is the one who gives or does not give the increase. And we must get that drilled into our heads. In Romans 1, Paul says, the power of God is in the gospel for salvation. It's the message. Telling people that Christ died for their sins and they need to be saved. That's the power. Not how you say it. Not that we shouldn't say it well. Don't misunderstand. But the power isn't in what we learn. The power is in the message. And that's why those of you who know Christ, that's why you know Christ today. Because of the power of that message. So, for Paul, his character was everything to him. It was every single thing. Colossians chapter 2. Chapter 4 and verse 2. Devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with an attitude of thanksgiving. Praying at the same time for us as well, that God may open up to us a door for the word so that we may speak forth the mystery of Christ, for which I have also been imprisoned, in order that I may make it clear in a way I ought to speak. See, he had to do it right, he wanted to do it right, and he learned how to do it right, and he wanted them to pray that he would say it right. And then he tells them, conduct yourselves with wisdom toward the outsiders, making the most of the opportunity. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned as it were with salt, so that you may know how you should respond to each person. What a tremendous statement. He's asking for them to pray that he will say it correctly. Not because he thinks that the power is in him, but it's in the message that he preaches. Keep that in mind. What you believe is who you are. And it will show out the way you live your life. And it'll show out the way I live mine. So there's a mixture of ability and character there. So whatever God calls you to do, learn all you can do to do it the best you can. Don't neglect it. The As a Christian student, you have a responsibility for you are called of God to be a student. But never forget that humility leaves the results of our work. And that's very serious when you have that very clear in mind. Now, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, Paul says some things that we need to look at just briefly and then of course. Chapter 2, verse 1 of 1 Corinthians, Paul says, "And when I came to you in Corinth, I did not come with superiority of speech or of wisdom, proclaiming to you the testimony of God." I didn't depend on cleverness. I didn't try to trick you. I didn't try to say things in a way that you I came to you to bring you a message that has the power within itself. And he says in verse 2, "For I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." Now, don't misunderstand Paul here. He's not saying we don't need to know anything but the preaching of the gospel. He's not using the word know there in terms of ignorance. I don't want to know anything. He's using it in terms of I don't want to depend on anything for the power of the gospel to have its effect. It's in the gospel message. I don't have to depend on anything that I do for it to make sense. Then in verse 3, "And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling." Paul, when he left the office, air-conditioned office of the Pharisee, he found himself where? Out on the street, out on the road, and he was in difficult straits, and he had never been in that before. He had no idea what he was in. And so he found himself in a difficult situation. He faced things where he was scared to death in another passage. He felt Paul scared to death. That's what he said. In verse 4, "And my message and my preaching were not in persuasive words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power of God." I didn't come to you and throw all my rhetoric stuff on you to try to convince you. I did, but I didn't do it trusting in that to change you. I did it because it's my job to do the best job I can. But the power to change you is in the gospel. Give praise and honor and glory to God for that. And then, verse 5, "That your faith should not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God." Your faith isn't developed because somebody was good at what they did. Your faith was developed by the power of the gospel message. And so, faith must not be built on man's wisdom, but on the power of God. People change by the power of God, not by my power to change them. Remember Lydia in the book of Acts, when Paul came to her to explain the gospel. What does it say in the scriptures around that passage? That the Spirit of God opened her heart so she could believe what Paul said. It takes all the I stuff out of this ceremony. Mm-hmm. In a biblical, I mean, we shouldn't celebrate. So, how important and how serious this all is? Well, two things. Go to the next phase of your life using all you have learned to glorify God. Keep learning the rest of your life in the context of your life in Christ. The fact that you're Christians, let that handle how you do what you do. And keep learning in every context of your life. And I would say it this way, hone your skills because they are God's gift to you. They're your gift. Nobody else has your gifts. They might have some of them. They don't have them like you do. They don't have them like I do. That's why we're not all the same. In fact, none of us are the same. We're all different. Beautiful creature. But when you do that, secondly, be sure as you graduate that you place whatever you learn in your education on the foundation of your character. Build your education on your character. Don't build your doing your character on your doing. Don't put it backwards. If you do, what will happen is you will define your life by what you do. You don't mind. That's too much pressure. Way too much pressure. So what that's going to help you do, you're going to be able to defeat pride, like MacArthur did. And you're going to look at it and you're going to say, this success is not about me, it's about what the Lord is doing. And you're going to be able to defeat the whole issue of depression and discouragement. And somehow, I'm not as successful as this. God help us. Learn these things and grow in them. Do not measure your success by the effectiveness of your doing. And in your doing, measure your life. Father, you have set an example, Paul, who's a man who knew, if anybody did, how to come with words of wisdom to convince people, to take it upon himself, to bring the gospel in a way that's going to change the world. Well, Father, you changed the world for him. He was faithful, but you brought him. Help us here as we deal with our view of what it is to be educated. May it grow, may it mature in us. Lord, I pray for Caitlin and Heidi as they go out. Bless them in a wonderful way. As they begin to develop their views of these things and they begin to put them into practice in their own life at the various levels as they reach the different steps, the different degrees. Father, bless them.
Thank you, Pastor Seeker, and thank you, Mr. Dupont, and I want to thank Colonel Riley, too. You know, just as an aside, Colonel Riley makes things look so easy. I see him on the phone. Thanks a lot. I teach the aesthetic students to notice things visually, and whereas he has this attack helicopter in the background, the girls have set this sparkly pink thing with flowers, and I'm wearing a dress. So thank you, Colonel, for that. So I have the pleasure now of presenting the class of 2020 to the Board of Directors. But before I do, I'm going to talk a few things about our diploma requirements for those that aren't familiar with them. Our diploma requires 28 credits. Students take 4 years of omnibus reading, discussing, and writing about great works of literature, history, and theology. They take 4 years of reasoning and logic through our math program. They take at least 3 years of challenging science courses, including physical science, biology, and chemistry. They take 2 courses in economics. They take 2 years of Latin. And if they've already had Latin in earlier years, they take 2 years of Spanish. They take 4 aesthetics courses and 4 rhetoric courses. In their final rhetoric course, they write a significant paper on a controversial subject and then defend their argument before a panel. So our diploma reflects a very rigorous course of study, and completing the additional challenge of calculus and physics makes a student eligible for our honors diploma, and both Heidi and Caitlin have earned an honors diploma. The academic world recognizes high grade point averages. At Geneva, we place a higher value on a student's character, and that's what Pastor Seeker was just talking about. And character may never be reflected in the GPA. Nevertheless, high grades, especially here, represent an achievement, and I will tell you what a few of the terms mean. The student with the highest academic standing is the class valedictorian. This rank is determined by GPA and credits, grade point average and credits. The student with the second highest standing is the class salutatorian. There was a tiny margin between these two this year on grade point average. Both had extremely high standing. So the titles, historically, were associated with speeches that the students gave. The salutatorian would give the salutation or opening speech, and the valedictorian would give the vale caceri to say farewell. Finally, there are what's known as Latin honors. Cum laude means with praise or with honor. Graduating cum laude at Geneva means having earned a GPA of 3.5 to 3.69 out of 4. Magna cum laude means with great honor or with great praise. Graduating magna cum laude means having earned a cumulative grade point average of 3.70 to 3.99. And our two graduates both earned magna cum laude honor, and that's on their diploma. Those who graduate magna cum laude with great honor get to wear a gold braid on their gown. And those graduating with a GPA of 3.3 to 3.69 get to wear a silver braid on their gowns, but our whole class earned gold. By the way, the tassels on the caps are traditionally worn on the right side until they receive their diplomas, then the tassels are moved to the left side. I know some of you are also wondering what the colors on the robes mean, and I know you're thinking, red is the blood of the students that we extract from them, and black represents the bruises that they get. But actually, black is traditional, and the colors that Dr. Yoon and Dr. Sewell and I are wearing are from our graduates. And with that, I would now like to say to the chairman and to the other members of the board of Geneva Academy, I, as headmaster of Geneva Academy, certify that these two students have completed the requirements of the Geneva Academy High School Diploma, Honors Diploma, and I commend them to you for the conferring of their diplomas. So Dr. Sewell and Dr. Yoon, would you come up, please? Dr. Sewell is our chairman of the board, and Dr. Yoon is our vice chairman of the board. And diplomas are here. And first, I would like to call up Heidi Felicia Duclos.
I see that.
I agree.
going to call them back up in just a minute, but before that, we would like to show a video that Allie Pascal put together, highlighting both Heidi and Caitlin. So good. Have the lights, and we'll watch the video.
Caitlin has always had an interest in art, and thinking about her love of landscape paintings makes me wonder if people are like the paintings they prefer. Caitlin is steady and true, faithful, trustworthy. She appreciates the beauty of creation. She's a musician. I would trust my car to Caitlin, my home, and my little ones, although I don't have little ones anymore. Caitlin can be as rowdy as anyone else in the right circumstance, but her mind would put a check on too much wildness, and she'd be right back on a steady course in no time. Anyone that has Caitlin as a friend has at least one person they can count on. I've enjoyed reading Caitlin's papers over the years as they have turned over again and again the desire to awaken appreciation of the Creator through true beauty. I am going to be very sad to see the last of the Riley clan go, but I cannot wait to talk with her about interior design in the years ahead. Caitlin, I miss my face.
I still remember the first time I ever saw Caitlin. She was just a tiny little thing and so cute and so unsure of herself, but so happy at the same time. Over the last few years, I've seen her mature into a woman. She is confident and she is graceful. Everyone loves Caitlin. I don't know what it is about the Riley children, but they're all just so cool. I'm actually kind of a little jealous of them, but Caitlin is just a breath of fresh air. She's just so easy to take in. She's like a bright yellow daffodil on a cold spring day. She just warms your heart, fills your life with color and laughter. She has gone from being very unsure of herself, and now she walks up on stage and just commands everyone's attention. She has an amazing presence in front of people. She has poise and she has dignity, and she's able to say something and make you believe it, almost like you had thought of it yourself. She's very gifted, but you wouldn't necessarily know it because she makes everything look easy. She plays it off like it's just a natural thing for her to be that way. And I do believe that the Lord has gifted her with the ability to be so humble when she has been given so many gifts. The thing I'll miss most about Caitlin is her kindness, her steady strength of character, and her beautiful spirit.
Compassionate, understanding, always smiling.
those that look up to her as she looks up to Christ?
Well, I'm coming to the close of my 7th year teaching at Geneva. During those years, there's always been a revival. And Caitlin is kind of bringing up the rear of this group. Of course, we're going to miss the Rileys, and we're going to greatly miss Caitlin being at the school. When I think of Caitlin, I think of someone who's loving, caring, bright, intelligent, steadfast. If I was a little kid and could pick my mom, Caitlin would be on the short list. Caitlin has a quiet, unassuming, comforting strength that others draw from. She always has it to give. It seems to be a well that's available to everybody all the time. It's very comforting to have her around. I'm just going to miss her deeply.
Heidi is like that bouncy knee of hers. Is that too much caffeine? Is it nervousness? Should I be concerned? Well, for the moment, it is energy, and I love energy. Heidi came to the school and immediately showed talent, interest, and skills with personal drive. She is fun to have in class and is a bit feisty. I think that is her middle name, by the way. Heidi Feisty Duclos. Her GPA through high school, as of the latest report card, is either the highest ever achieved in Geneva or very close, and that says a lot. What is remarkable about that is that I've never observed Heidi to be arrogant of her achievements. She always seems as baffled or daunted by assignments as anyone else, and then crushes them. There was only one project of hers that was a failure. She tried to build a Gothic cathedral nave out of plaster, and the pieces kept breaking. All she had left, after many attempts, was a pile of painted and dusty rubble. I forced her to bring the broken pieces in so we could learn by the failure. I don't think she likes the lemon, but I have always kept some of those pieces. I could see and appreciate the effort, though it did not succeed. And I think God does the same with our broken attempts. I'm curious to see where that bouncy one goes in the next few years.
Heidi is the kind of person who you feel warm from. She is compassionate, kind, and thoughtful. When I met Heidi in art class, I remember her always setting high expectations for herself, striving for beauty and perfection in her artwork. I pray that her drive and talent for creating beautiful things will be clear in all that she does, bringing much glory to her.
Heidi is a force to reckon with. She is fierce on the ultimate frisbee field, on the dodgeball field, and less importantly, in classroom. The summer before she came to Geneva, I tutored her in math. Both she and her mother told me that she was bad at math. Little did they know that Heidi is exactly what I look for in a math student. She wants to know the why behind things, and she won't settle for anything less. She is tenacious in her quest for true understanding. She is quick to see connections between ideas, and she doesn't hesitate to be the voice of opposition when needed. She's often the first one to offer a word of encouragement to both her peers, the younger students at this school, and quite honestly, even the math teachers sometimes. She not only freely offers encouragement, she's also bold enough to hold other students accountable for their actions and their words. Many times, I've overheard her in the hallway speaking to a younger student, firmly but with love, about the actions that they've taken. And I really admire that about Heidi. And yet Heidi is somehow able to do it with strength and with grace. I am most definitely going to miss having Heidi around the school, seeing her cheerful smile and hearing her beautiful voice singing to the Lord. But I do look forward to seeing her grow and mature as a woman.
When I think of Heidi, I think of passion and energy and intelligence and a vibrance and a love for life. I think of a person who is incredibly capable. And when Heidi walks into the room, if Heidi's having a good day, everybody's going to have a good day. I'm going to be very excited to see what Heidi does with all the gifts and talents that God has blessed her. I think I've climbed Mount Dielson more times with Heidi and her family than any other student at Geneva. And one time when we went hiking, it was earlier in the morning and the sun was just rising, and there was some Virga rain falling, special moment for all of us to see that. And it's so representative of Heidi. I don't think we're going to see a lot of Heidis.
Girls, why don't you stand and be here, and yes, come on up, and Dr. Kessler will be right here, and then when he closes, we will give you a cheer, and then we'll have our reception.
I've not had the opportunity to do much with him, although I got in a little bit of fun in the capstone process. I remember having gone through many of these in my own life, these, I would echo what Pastor Seeger said, and this is the commencement of the beginning of your life in this new stage, the skills and the love that have been poured into you. And while I was thinking of a benediction or a blessing, I thought of a Celtic one. I don't know if you know it, it's one of my favorites. And I thought I would add a little bit of Trinitarian reflection to it. Basically, another way of saying the same thing, you might say. Let's pray. May the road rise up to meet you, and may the wind always be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, and the rain fall soft upon the fields until we meet again. And may God hold you in the palm of his hand. May God's good creation always sustain you. God's Holy Spirit always blow you in his will and his way, which is truth or Christ. May Christ, the Son of Righteousness, always shine in and through you to a world that is full of darkness. And may the dew of his blessing fall upon you fresh every day until we meet again in him. May God hold you in the palm of his hand as you commence this new part of your life.
Congratulations! Yeah.